Hello YouTube, I hope you're on fire today. Promises are made to be kept. Today we are talking about editing and effects in Premiere Pro. In the last creative vlog, I show you the behind the scenes of a video I made for my CrossFit box. By the way, thanks for the feedback. Apparently you like that we talk about filmmaking and not just about photography for once. All the pre-production and production parts were in this video. Now we'll take care of the post-production part. First, we'll see how I organize the project like this to be as efficient as possible. Then we'll talk about editing. The purpose is not to be technical. It's not an introduction to Premiere. It's more to share editing philosophies that you can apply to any software, the way I think about the rhythm, the story, etc. And at the end, I will explain the effect and the famous transition, giving you specific examples. Note that this video will have a sequel, since we'll see everything about sound and music afterward. I didn't want it to be too long, and since it's quite differentiated topics, it seems more relevant like that. Let's stop the blah blah, let's go. The first essential point in this kind of project is the organization. The more organized you are, the less time you will waste and the more productive you will be. You really must not neglect this part. You have to accept to lose time or to have the feeling that you are wasting time tidying everything up to gain time afterward. My goal is to convince you that this work is crucial, but then the way you're going to do it, it's up to you. I'm going to show you how I organize myself, and you're free or not to be inspired by it. You just have to find the criteria that correspond to your working methods. My organization is quite classical, so it can be a good starting point for you. Folder number one, I'm going to put all the project's captured videos in it, what we call rushes. Inside, they are classified by types. As we saw last time, we have three different elements. Everything that corresponds to the movement, the words, then portraits, and finally the ambient videos, the premises, etc. I also rename all my videos so I don't waste time to know what each rush corresponds to. Folder number two, this is where I'm going to put my stock footage. It's all the things I'd like to integrate into my montage, but that I couldn't film by myself and had to find on the internet. It's super important. We'll talk about it, especially about the transitions, a little bit later in the video. The third folder with all the graphic elements, which will contain, for example, images if I use photos in my editing, or what I call overlay, graphic elements like light clicks, etc. But I also put the framing elements, black bars, etc. We'll come back to this later. A folder for everything related to sound, with the music and sound design, voiceover, which we'll talk about in the next video.
Once I have all four folders created and filled out, I'm going to drag them directly into my Premiere Pro editing panel so that they're organized exactly the same. Only then I create specific folders for what's local on my computer and what's only for the editing software.
On my computer, I will add a folder for the project files, Premiere Pro and possibly After Effects files if needed, plus a last folder that will contain the different exports. In Premiere, I'm just going to add an extra folder that I'm going to name Sequence, and in which we are going to find what I call pre-comp. So it's not the right term. In Premiere, we talk about nesting, but I come from After Effects and, you know, old habits die hard. By the way, I also have a folder dedicated to possible composition that I could import via dynamic link from After Effects. And finally, a last folder when I will put the different versions of my project as we go along.
The goal is really to waste as little time as possible looking for elements. Efficiency. And in the same vein, I also invite you to rethink your work environment in relation to your own working habits.
Here you can change the workspaces according to the task you are doing with the predefined spaces. But once you have analyzed your way of working, try to create your own environment based on your way of thinking and editing. Here I use a predefined workspace for the screen capture, but I have my own spaces based on the projects I'm usually working on.
Another point, which will depend on how you work. Personally, I'm a very visual guy, and I need to see how the rushes fit together. That's why I use color codes.
You can change the default colors. That's what I've done in relation to the types of elements I put in my timeline. You can see that I've done this mostly in relation to the videos I produce for YouTube. Try to see what type of video you produce the most and organize yourself accordingly.
Okay, the editing philosophy. The problem is that it's really something very personal to each editor. Everyone has a different approach to the work, but I'm gonna try to explain at least how I do it. I use a funnel technique. I create big blocks that I will crumble little by little until I get the piece I'm interested in.
I will already create three sequences corresponding to the three types of images at my disposal: words, portraits, ambiences. It is obvious that the structural body of my narration will be done mostly with all the exercises. It's the video topic. Portraits and atmospheres, that's what will allow me, one, to dynamize the editing, too, to bring information but also emotion with the human elements. For each sequence comes the first and usually the most boring step, watching each rush one by one. I'm going to find and place on my timeline all the interesting moments, the good pieces. On this kind of editing, I know I only need a few seconds, just this little I don't know what moments, but there's something in it. I put them all in a row on my timeline, organized by genre. Once I have all that, I'm going to start refining it, trying to make connections, creating little stories. At 80%, the easiest way is just continuity in action. For example, I have a part about squats, here about pull-ups. I try to arrange them, not necessarily in the most logical way, i.e. chronologically, but in the most interesting way, or sometimes the most visual way. Once I have all these little stories, and I've started deleting what wasn't working with it, I try to organize it into an overall framework, which will fit the structure of my final cut.
I told you, we'll deal with the sound next time, but that structure is derived from the sound elements. The audio is an essential part. The quality of a video comes 80% from the sound. Here the narration is also carried by a voiceover. Taking this into account, I compose my video in three parts. If you have heard of storytelling, yes, it's a simple three-act structure. What is that? Easy, it's a rule that explains that every story is composed of three parts. A beginning, a middle, and a hand. Basic, yes. Obviously, it's a bit more complicated. Rather, we talk about exposure, confrontation, and resolution. In fact, it's even again a little bit more complicated. But we are not going into further details today. Every story is about conflict.
You are tearing me apart, Lisa!
Conflict in the broadest sense of the word. We have an initial situation, something unexpected happens, the situation has changed. What we also call the normal, the explosion, the new normal.
This is the format I applied here. The central part of the voiceover will correspond to the setup of the situation, to establish the universe in which we evolve. It is JP's vision of not only CrossFit but also his philosophy of life that is exposed. And we have a first music that is quite calm but deep, that immerses us in the state of mind. Then you have the explosion. We explained its mantra, now you're going to live it, you're going to feel it. You have this very dynamic, very immersive montage. And to finish, the rhythm comes down with a few words of conclusion. We have a new situation in which you have lived so many things that you too, now you have the same mentality. You too are resilient.
All you want to do now is to go to the nearest CrossFit box and explode your clean and jerk PR. I still advise you to avoid isoback days or the overheads, that too it's awful. Oh, and snatches. Why do I do CrossFit? I have organized my blocks, my little stories where they fit the most. And I refine, I cut the editing so that the rhythm is in line with the part where they are. The rhythm, we could make a whole video out of it. And yet it's also something quite difficult to transmit technically, since it's something, again, very personal, the feeling of being on the right timing. The only trick I can give you is this funnel technique. You edit, you look at it, you cut it, you look at it again, you cut it again, you look at it again, blah, blah, blah. Always keep in mind, cut the fat, go to the point. Sometimes it's only one frame, sometimes you have to remove much more.
It's also for the rhythm that I'm going to bring back our additional portrait or ambient shoots, and also the graphics, the insert, what I called stock footage earlier. When I have my first global montage, what I want is to bring in elements that will support the narration, that will bring meaning. And a good way to do that is also to use some graphic elements that I couldn't film, or simply that I don't have the ability to film.
And now it's the perfect time to talk about the sponsor of our video. No, I'm kidding. This video is not sponsored in the sense that I'm not paid by them. Let's talk about the service I use, namely Artlist for everything that is music and sound design, and Artgrid for everything that is stock footage. A year ago, when I started my channel, I bought a subscription to Artlist just for music. We'll talk about why I choose them in the next video. This summer, they contacted me to propose me to create affiliate links on my channel. Basically, if you want to subscribe to their service and use the links that are in the description, they will pay me a small commission. You, on your side, you get 2 months for free.
Thank you!
I also got another compensation. As they are super nice, they offer me a year subscription to Artgrid, and they extended the Artlist subscription I had already paid for music to sound design also.
So, Artgrid stock footage service. You can do a direct search if you already know what you are looking for, or use the proposed themes. For example, urban shots, travel. What I like is also the possibility to refine by type of shot, for example, which type of camera movement, which framing, etc. The most obvious use will be to get sport visual to increase the material at my disposal, but as we work efficiently on the pre-production part, yeah, we don't like any. We could also have looked for images that would have been difficult to produce by ourselves, such as a great drone shot to introduce the video.
That was even the initial idea, but in the end I preferred to start right away with this first portrait from the back, the jump cut that also puts you directly in the action, and put the exposition shot right after. Now, as usual, we are not going to do anything like the others. What we are going to look for on Artgrid is visual universes impossible to obtain otherwise than graphically. We're gonna take a specific example. I will choose this sequence and we will analyze it together. I wanted to find a way to express that rush of adrenaline that you can feel during a walk. And for me, visually, it was a blood surge. You know what I mean? Well, how can you get a shot like that?
On Artgrid, I did a little research to find this very typical underwater wave effect, which can remind you of this violent sensation, but which also comes close to the feeling of being submerged. It's a visual that has nothing to do with our editing, so how do we mix it with the rest? The goal here is to go from one portrait to another, two very calm portraits, calm in terms of rhythm, and to do so by inserting a lot of dynamism between the two.
There are no particular rules. As I'll tell you, it's a lot of feeling, but we will try to see what happens frame by frame.
First, we have our portrait, and now I want to incorporate a sense of emergency using the timer shoot. These are two very calm shots, nothing very nervous happens. I have my timer a few frames, then I zoom to the closest, barely 3 frames, just to get a glimpse of it. On one frame only, I have just the texture, the color of the timer, and then I mix it to the portrait, closer this time, either with blend modes or here just with the opacity. You get closer again to have an extreme close-up on the eye. Here it was a very fixed shot, so I animated the rotation to give movement and make it more dynamic. Then we have our wave videos. I accelerated them to the maximum. The action has to happen in a few frames, and then I play with the curve to give it this red tint. I mix two rushes together just with the fade. You just have to make sure that the movements match each other. Now I can move on to my other portrait, once again playing with the blend modes and opacity. I have also made a small insert here of the same portraits at a different scale. Mix it with the blend mode, here screen, you know, just to give a little glitch effect like poof. I also did the same kind of effect here with another video of a liquid, I think paint, found on Artgrid.
For the color on JP's portrait, I simply use my lightsaber, the one we tested in another video. I'll leave you a link somewhere. You don't have to do swooshes every time to go from one shot to another. You will give even more rhythm just with cuts. Going from one cut to another in a fluid way, yes, it takes experience. But the basic principle is to give the eye a reference point to hold on to and to maintain it on the next shot.
So it can be done by movement, continuing the same movement from one cut to the other. But it can also be done by maintaining shapes, or as we just saw with the color, trying to keep the red. That's why I had graphics between two shots, like leaks that I'm going to integrate between my cuts with blend modes. It is also a way to graphically enhance some shot. For that, you have to try to find cool light effects, for example here with glass diffraction, which I used here.
There's also a shot that I wanted to do in super slow motion, you know, clapping hands with powder like that. But if you start throwing chalk all over the box, JP make you pay for it in burpees, and I didn't want to tempt the devil. So, Artgrid.
Look, this one is really great. With a little color correction, it will be perfect. Once again, blend mode, opacity, a bit of sound design behind it to make it blend, and you get a really interesting effect.
Let's try to analyze another moment. Let's see, the running.
You start by establishing the situation. He laces his shoes, he prepares himself. This effect is simply 3 photos in a loop, nothing magical. He starts running and it just cuts on different parts of the body or different views, shoulder shot, front shot, etc. And look how I'm moving between two cuts. There I could have done swoosh transition in camera, but instead I'm going to recycle the last pieces of some rushes. Here when I'm done running with him and I take my camera back in my hand. A few frames and it goes from one shot to another.
You have this feeling of movement to go from one image to another, but it's not just lost in the blur. You always have additional information, an idea of the environment. In short, there is no magic trick. In fact, in the end, it's quite simple. It's just time spent doing tests, making mistakes. The epic transitions, it's okay, we have 2 shoots that we can cut one to the other. We're going to put a fast move in the blur between the two, and don't worry, it's going to look great. Here I have a different approach. I have the same shots that I still can't cut next to each other, but I'll try to mix them together. Mix them graphically or introduce visual information, sometimes imperceptible, between the two. It is also to bring rhythm by changing textures, by adding noise, for example, using different colorimetry, some very advanced, some very raw. You saw that I also often change the image ratio between 16:9 cinemascope, 4:3. The purpose of the change is to give rhythm, but also to surprise the audience every time. Okay, that's what I had to say about the editing part. If you like this kind of edit, don't hesitate to test it in your video editing software, but once again, it's not a a new reference to hang on to. The style has to match the narration, has to make sense of what you want to say. If you have questions, you have the comment section. If you have a lot of love in your heart, you can explode the like button. If you want to follow my adventures, you can subscribe to the channel. If you like little bells, you can activate the notification. And most of all, don't forget to share, that's what helps me the most. We'll meet again very, very soon for the last part dedicated to sound. Very important, don't miss it. See you, mate. Keep on creating.